if you're on time.
Hey, Doc.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome here to the new Black Wall Street Market. It is an honor and a privilege to be here before you celebrating what has been given to us as a celebration of our culture and our heritage, Black History Month. This is our beginning, this is a kickoff, and this is one of the highlights that I wanted to present to you. This is a very, very good educational and entertaining presentation written, produced, and directed by none other than the producer and director, Mr. Lawrence Walker. Now, this particular video is presenting the story of the female during World War II, and I believe you're going to learn a lot. You're going to see a lot, and based on Mr. Walker's 30 years of research, you're going to learn a lot. Mr. Walker, as you see on the screen, has spent 30 years traveling around the world, picking up and gathering information so it can be documented truth that he presents to you. I will take this time to basically just introduce to you this filmmaker, this educator, this articulate gentleman. Come on, Lawrence. I present to you Lawrence Walker, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon, everybody. How are you today? I try to project my voice is very soft. I don't have a deep baritone voice like the gentleman that just gave me the introduction. We won't belittle you too much. We'll try to stay in focus because we have a little time limit. Thank you for taking the time and coming out and learning a little about a lost history that's been lost in time. Before we start, can we just bow our heads for 10 seconds to give praise to those heroes and sheroes that have come before us during World War II? Thank you. Thank you very much. My mother used to always say, in order for you to know where you're going, you have to know where you come from. He that forgets the past is doomed to fail in the future. I'll repeat that again to you later on in the program. Audience, how many of you have known about African-American men that served during World War II? Raise your hands, please. Thank you. Now, before you heard of this program, how many of you have heard about African-American women that served during World War II? Raise your hands. Thank you. The ones that did not raise their hands, don't feel bad because you're in the same boat as me. Back in 1995, 96, a historian in New Jersey approached me about my next project. And he indicated to me, I was at the time, the Tuxedo film project had came on HBO. And it caught my attention that they did the film, but nobody did the documentary. So I decided to start doing some research at the National Archive. And I decided to start focusing on the Tuxedo Airmen. Well, this historian wrote about me, read about me talking about my next project, which is going to be on the Tuxedo Airmen. And he called me at my house. And he indicated to me, you don't need to do this project on the Tuxedo Airmen. It's already been done. HBO had just finished it. Why don't you do your next project on African-American women in World War II? And I'm like, wow, I've never heard of that. He said, why don't you come to my house? So I jumped in my car, raced to his house. He asked me to come in. He said, have a seat. And he went up into his attic and he came back down with this huge old scrapbook. You can't find scrapbooks like that anymore. And he put that scrapbook on my lap and it had dust on it this thick. And he said to me, open up that scrapbook. And I began to open up the pages. and I saw these beautiful black and white pictures of Tuskegee Airmen in uniform. Little that I knew, his father was one of the commanding officers there in the fort, and his mother was there too. He said, keep turning the pages. I kept turning the pages, and then all of a sudden, I saw these black and white pictures of African-American women in uniform. I said, wow. He said, let me tell you the story on how these black women served and served proudly. And they never got credit at that time for over 50 years. And before I left this house, he said to me, this is what you need to focus your next project on. The Tuskegee Airmen project is done, but focuses on this project on how black women served and served proudly. I didn't waste no time. Within a week, I jumped in my car, went to Washington, D.C. at the National Archive, the Library of Congress, and I started researching, collecting the pictures, collecting the footage. I knew I was on the right track because I said to the librarian in that research area, she said to me, you need a reference number for these pictures. And once I pulled up the reference number, she said, it's going to take me time to go upstairs to the vault and pull down all those pictures. I said, take all the time you want. I'm right here. I'll be here for a week. So when she came down with that cart, it was 15 boxes on it and dust on those boxes this thick. I knew I was on the right track. Those pictures have never been pulled in over 50 years. People out there, if you have your cell phones on, or beepers, or any electronic equipment, please turn it off so the person in front of you, behind you, can enjoy the interviews and the film on this historic project that has never been seen. And most of these women, I read CNN's report the other day, it's only 5 women left out of the 855 women that served during that period. They're all gone. So it was my job to keep this history. When we come back, we're going to have a Q&A question, and watch the documentary very closely, because I have questions for you. We're going to play a little Jeopardy game. I want to see who's sleeping and who's watching the documentary. And the questions I ask you, if you get it right, I'll have a surprise for you. Enjoy Sweet Georgia Brown, Impact, Courage, Sacrifice, and Will. Thank you.
I felt this was an opportunity to do something new. And the truth was that this is the first time that I have known in my lifetime when they had started something new and positive and included black women in it, black people in it from the beginning.
We can adjust to almost any situation and make something out of nothing.
We were determined that we weren't going to get those white girls out of the world.
These white girls got on another truck, and the black girls got on another truck, and we've never seen anyone again. I told them what it's going to be.
And I went in there when they needed women to replace men.
Colonels and majors control the whites.
Can talk to a king, I can talk to the janitor.
We're all just people.
When the stories are being told, we want to know, what did the black people do? Were there black people there?
We weren't being drafted. I volunteered.
Shade of sweet Georgia Brown.
It's taken a long time for us to be found and remembered.
It was not until World War II that women were officially allowed to serve in great numbers in the armed forces. The Army had the Women's Army Corps, the Navy had women accepted for volunteer emergency service, and the Coast Guard had the SPARs. The majority of African-American women served in the WAC. They remained in segregated units, as did the African-American men. Although the Navy intended to increase the number of African-Americans to 10%, there were still less than 50 black waves by 1945. The U.S. Coast Guard had even less in the SPARs. Out of the highest number of women in the military during this period, 271,000, only 4,000 were African-American women, simply because there just were not any opportunities for them. African-American women continued to serve from the Korean conflict through Vietnam to Operation Desert Storm.
To train, equip, and get these men to the front is a task of the Army's Chief of Staff, General George C. Marshall.
The conservation of manpower is a matter of first importance. The Women's Army Auxiliary Corps was organized to assist in meeting this need by releasing soldiers from non-combat duties. These women are to take over the jobs of soldiers behind the lines and here at home. Already they are doing this in a very fine manner. The Corps is the most important element of the Army, and I personally I'm intensely interested in its rapid development in strength as well as in training.
Mrs. Ovita Cope Hoppe, taking the oath of office as Director of the Women's Army Auxiliary Corps, the Secretary of War appointed her on May 16, 1942, to organize, train, and command a force of women to take the places of men behind the lines. A big order, already partially filled. Thousands of WACs, trained and disciplined the Army way, are now on duty all over this country and overseas.
So I knew I was going to go into the military. My family didn't think it was such a good idea, but my in-laws did, and my 80-year-old grandmother thought it was great, and that's what I wanted to do, and I did, and that's why I joined. And I got into supply. They must have asked me about how did you get interested, and I had mentioned maybe working in supply. So I ended up, my whole career was in supply.
Women was best placed was thought to be in the home, protecting the home, not in the military service. However, as history has shown us time and time again, need will always supersede policy and preference. So I'm saying despite the reluctance to recruit women for our military, amongst military leadership, not thinking about what women had done previously.
You always say, you know, you get it started and when all the good parts are used up, then you open the doors for the rest of them. And I wanted to be part of this group.
Congresswoman Edith Marsh Rogers from Massachusetts, foresaw, and she went to the military leaders of the services as well as the congressmen and said, look, this war is imminent. What are you going to do with women? Hence the name, Women's Army Auxiliary Corps in May of 1942. That was very intentional because it was to reassure the congressmen that these women aren't in the military. They're just associated with the military. Now, the WAC did open its doors, and like any other contingent, you train officers first. And the WAC trained their officers at Fort Des Moines, Iowa. And when all the recruits reported there, we talked to Martha Putney, she could certainly tell you more detail because she was one of them.
and did a fine book for us called When the Nation Was in Need about the black whites. They were setting up segregated units, but that was consistent with Army policy to segregate blacks by unit assignment versus the Navy, which segregated blacks by duty assignment. And so they found out what was going on. And this went on for some time. And they were in separate units, had their own barracks, their own section of camp, and everything. Couldn't use the pool the same time the white whites did.
One of the things that shocked me at the beginning was that there was such a great need for nurses in World War II that they were thinking about drafting white women to be nurses. Bills were going into Congress about how can we get more nurses, when black women were volunteering to say, we want to serve, we want to be a part of this. Mabel Stoppers and the Colored Graduate Nurses Association were working hard to see that black women also had an opportunity to serve in the war.
I was born in Hull Hospital August 29, 1919. I started working as a librarian in Fort Clark, Texas, in the Army. I was so gung-ho, man. I was getting out there hunting the girls. And when I left Des Moines for sending to Texas, I volunteered to drill with girls. And I know I was off the peak. And I gave the command on the wrong foot, you know, to the rear march. And they bumped into each other and laughed. And I called them to attention and stopped. And I made the mistake over and over again. Let me think. And I said, I stopped them. I said, you, go to the CO. They went on right and said, you want to learn how to drill, you should learn how to drill.
When the clouds break the ground, go marching in, go marching in. When the clouds go marching in, oh Lord, I want to be in that number. Oh, when the clouds go marching in.
First of all, when the Navy started admitting women, and there was a huge recruitment campaign underway, women wrote in for applications, and they'd find out that these were not white women they had spoken with. They were recruited women, over 200,000 of them. And because of the discrimination that was occurring in society in general, Jim Crow was the lord of the land at that time, we didn't make maximum use of all available men or woman power in this case.
Under pressure by Adam Clayton Powell, Eleanor Roosevelt, Mary McCloy Bethune, the NAACP, and the black press, African-American women joined the armed forces. The National Council of Negro Women, founded by Mary McCloy Bethune in 1935, consisted of several black women's organizations. Bethune was an invited member of the Advisory Council for the Women's Interest Section and later of the National Civilian Advisory Committee for the Women's Army Corps.
Democracy is for me and for 12 million black Americans a goal towards which our nation is marching. It is a dream and an idea in whose ultimate realization we have a deep and abiding faith. For me, it is based on Christianity, in which we confidently entrust our destiny as a people. Under God's guidance in this great democracy, we are rising out of the darkness of slavery into the light of freedom.
This distinguished African-American woman who held a number of leadership positions in the country was the link between these organizations and the African-American community. ACWIS and NCAC officials constantly called on Bethune to influence African-American women to support efforts that they, white middle-class women, defined as important. One such effort was to encourage educated women with high moral character to join both groups.
And growing up in Florida at that time, I grew up in a depression. You either had to be a school teacher or a nurse because, you know, the segregation wouldn't allow you to be a cook in a big restaurant or something like that.
going into the different stores and so forth, applying for jobs, filling out applications. They had what they called government girls going to Washington to do clerical. Recruiters came to the schools, and the recruiters also came at that time to the churches. And the people I knew who had gone into the service were, you know, college people, higher caliber people, and so forth. And so I signed up for the Army as well.
Mrs. Roosevelt did not get along very well with her mother. Mary McLeod Bethune was one of the few black women invited to the White House. Mrs. Roosevelt used to have these luncheons where they dealt with different social issues. And as the first lady representing the president, she was often able to carry out her own social activism and agenda. And children was one of her key issues, child welfare, family issues.
Well, the Roosevelts appointed her as the director of the Negro Division of the National Youth Administration.
The mother-in-law and Bethune hit it off swimmingly. I don't think either party could have believed how well they did it.
Now, the Youth Administration was one of the New Deal programs, usually, again, for women. It was much of the training was domestic.
Here's Mrs. Bethune providing a personal bridge between a mother-in-law and her daughter-in-law. This is going to start to see in a relationship between these two women that starts even before the president, and he becomes president, Franklin Roosevelt becomes president.
There were different kinds of opportunities for young people to be trained. So she had dedicated her whole life to training people.
In fact, they met in Bethune's house in Washington quite regularly to support each other primarily, but also to consider the important positions that they did have.
Life was different growing up in 1942, but joining the military for African American women that came from all parts of the country and joining the Army from 1942 to 1945.
I signed up, and in April, the 1st of April, I was called. I quit the job at the department store, and our church needed a secretary. So I worked as a secretary, and I told the minister I would be there until they called me, you know. If they ever called first, I would go. And the Army called me before the government girls, and so I went to the Army. Well, Roosevelt didn't say black or white. He just said women. Thank God they have that. So we went down to Lexington recruiting station. And they didn't act like they didn't want it. So I took the written test, I passed. And let me say that, that was in January of 1943. I took the physical and I passed that.
I was born in a small town in Tennessee, Staten, Tennessee. My grandmother wanted to raise me. And I came back and I told Mama I had joined the Army. And the Mama didn't know what the Army was.
They were signing people up to go to Europe, the Charity Adams Colonel. There were supposed to have been 2 to 3 years of male backup that servicemen were not getting. And so, of course, she created the slogan, no male, no morale.
I was sort of laying around, and someone suggested to me, why don't you join the service? This was something said and did. And I said, really? So my dad thought it was a good idea. I was taking his place, so he signed the papers for me to join up.
Well, I just decided I wanted to do something to help out. I wasn't working. My parents were aged, and I just decided I wanted to do something to help out. We had a rural mayor to carry it. I went to the mailbox and got the mail, came back, sat down, was looking through it. And there was one paper that had a picture of a man on it saying, Uncle Sam wants you. I just threw it to the floor, looked at the rest of the mail. Then I looked down at the picture again, and I said, kept looking at it. I said, well, maybe, just maybe Uncle Sam's got you.
In the era leading to World War II, there were not real and highly visible class distinctions among Negroes as developed during the years following the war. We were all Negroes, some with more education than others,
some who had better paying jobs than others, some who lived in less segregated environments than others, some from more structured and stable families than others. The experiences we shared were discrimination in the nation's mores and legalized segregation in many sections of the country. Following the Great Depression of the late 30s, the job picture had worsened for Negroes. Last hired, first fired became the pattern in industry. When economic times were severe, even domestic help was frequently sacrificed.
The first WAC training center was at Fort Des Moines, Iowa, where Major Charity Adams Early was inducted into the military in Columbus, Ohio on July 13, 1942. Some of the women received promotions, and they were promoted on the basis of their abilities.
Charity Adams Early was the head of the 6th AAA to serve overseas, although there were some nurses who served in England, and there's some footage at the National Archives of General Davis receiving the nurses as they landed in England. So the 6th AAA, they were not the only ones to go to Europe, but they served there as a unit.
Putting race aside, all these women wanted to bring the war to a closer end, and very much sooner. Putting all that aside, they wanted to bring their loved ones home. Putting it aside, they were patriotic about their country. So it speaks volumes to me about the character of these women, knowing the kind of military that they were going into, to still go down and volunteer to say, I want to be a WAC, I want to be a WAVE, I want to be a SPAR, or whatever branch they were in, knowing that those would be the conditions under which they were going to serve, because the military is just a segment of society and often reflects societal standards.
Life just went on, you know. You had the regular things, you know. You got up in the morning, you showered, you dressed, you stood ready, you went to work. There were areas where you had to do chores, you know. You had kitchen duty sometimes. You had laboratory duty sometimes. And that was it, you. You didn't lounge around for nothing, you know what I'm saying? That was life really
happened. One morning, a letter with an unfamiliar return address arrived in the mail. I looked at it curiously, having no idea how familiar I would become with envelopes marked Army Service Forces. My strong faith had paid off. I had been accepted by the Women's Army Auxiliary Corps.
Well, I didn't know what I was getting into. But I trusted the people who had recommended me that, and one thing I was sure of, that the first group of women were going to be very highly protected. They were going to have no foolishness with this group of women. So I wasn't worried about it. I didn't know what it was all about. Did not know very much about the military, although I had grown up in the city with the largest infantry post in the country. I didn't know any soldiers. That was not the thing. So I was very happy to be received.
I was to report either July 13th or July 18th to be sworn in. That was definite enough. If I reported on July 13th, I would be sworn in and put on furlough for a week. If I reported on July 18th, I should come prepared to leave immediately from Fort Hays, Ohio for Des Moines, Iowa. To make things easier, I had a way out. If I did not choose to go into the Army, I did not have to report.
I got a letter and enclosed it, which it had in the envelope, an application to join the Women's Army Auxiliary Corps, as it was at first, the Women's Army Auxiliary Corps. And the letter that also said that I would enjoy this opportunity to do something new. They were looking for leaders, and you know, all the nice things you say make people join. And I was teaching school, and I liked that. I think I was a very good teacher. I still am.
If you could see me now, you'd know how blue I've been. One look is all you need to see the blue diamond. Perhaps then you'll realize I'm still in love with you. If you could see me now, you'd find me be brave and trying awfully hard to make my tears behave. But that's quite impossible. I'm still in love with you.
I was like carefree, happy gal. And I was still living with my mother, so there was restrictions. I had a plan one day to get away from that and be my own.
I've never been to a place out of Philadelphia. And all the captions says, see the world. That's what I wanted to do.
I heard a lot about it. I wanted to go. It was against my family. It was against my religion. I just wanted to go. Cloud Bethune and Mrs. Roosevelt. They were the ones who caused opportunities to be presented to African-American women in the military. They were not wanted at first in every war. They don't want them. And then when they find that it's a need, then they bring them in. Then when they bring them in, they want to do labor work.
I hear these women raving about their monkey men, about their fighting husbands and their no good friends. These poor women sit around all day and moan, wondering why their wandering papas don't come home. Why women don't worry.
I'm the first class of women in the Army. And I know of four of us. There may be some more out of 40 women. They had 40 black women and 400 white women in that first class. And out of that 40, 36 of us graduated. And out of that 36 now, there are 12 of us alive.
In Fort Des Moines, I was in the Caribbean. That was in the company work, training new recruits. That's what my job was when I was in Fort Des Moines. You had groups going to officer training school, you had going to clerical school, going to motor transport school. I wanted to go to motor transport school because that's where I was going to get to drive that Ammonite. They decided I would be best as a platoon sergeant.
Oh, I had to get a waiver to get in because I didn't weigh 100 pounds. And you're supposed to weigh at least 100. I started my basic training at Fort Devens, Massachusetts in July. I enlisted in April of 43, called to active duty July. Started my basic at Fort Devens, Mass. We took care of ourselves. And I had I think it was at Walla Walla where I had the only pair of nylons, you know, everything was rationed.
Well, they sent a ship over to pick us up. And we had gotten, about more than halfway there. And our captain came to us and he had said, the captain has discovered a bomb that the Germans had put in the water. I said, we're going to have to turn and go back to the United States because we were frightened, and we did. We traveled about 8 or 10 hours coming back to the United States and made a turn to the left, to the right, and went over and ended up in Birmingham, England.
African American women had two fronts of discrimination: females and males' personal encounters with segregation, racism, and gender was a common place in the military, and living conditions was hard, but the women stayed and worked together.
Funny thing about it, part of what the morning was called Stable Road. And you got there, and there were all white corporals and sergeants drilling the girls, and they would say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then we got transferred in another area, which was all black. And our black girl was like, hup, hup. I said, what the hell are they saying? You know, 1, 2, 3, 4,
At Fort Des Moines, there were no colored males. There were about 100, 150, maybe 200 white males. You know, the Army was in charge of the rest. Colonels and majors controlled the blacks, and they were white. Women officers had no place to go. They were not allowed in the officers' mess. In fact, they scattered us among them on officers' row. And of course, we were more or less islands on the row.
Now, there was a lady there by the name of W. Roundtree we talked about last time we were together, and Janet was with us then, who actually was a bit of they considered her a troublemaker, because every time something went wrong, she would call Mrs. Bethune, Mrs. Mary McLeod Bethune. Dr. Bethune was the official WAC advisor to the WAC director, Colonel Hobby, for Negro Affairs, if you will, at the time, in terms of the Negro WAC experience. So if they ever had a problem, they just called Washington. But when they figured out what W. Roundtree was doing, they gave her all these jobs to get off the base. They made her a recruiter. They told her she'd be a chauffeur. She said, I don't have a license. They still made her a chauffeur. Nobody tells the story like Debbie does. But it's just indicative of the agitation that was going on amongst these women, where they weren't accepting the situation in which they were serving, and were trying to do something to change it. In fact, when Mrs. Bethune came to Des Moines for a tour, Debbie took her to the O Club and stopped. And she said, why aren't you going in? She said, you can go in, but I can't go in. That was enough to change their policy.
Major Adams and her 68th Regiment had received orders from Major Margaret L. Philpott to go to Headquarters Staff Communications Zone in England to meet Brigadier General Benjamin O. Davis, the only Negro general in the entire military of the United States at the time.
And my friends, the people were so nice to us. They just loved us. Everything was so nice. And I said, when I got out of the Army, I said, I gotta go back overseas. But I want to see if you'll be still nice to us. I went back to London. And people were so sweet, they were nice. I went to France. It was all together different. No one spoke English. I couldn't understand how they changed so.
But the 6AAA sent over there to reduce this backlog of mail. You know, we're talking today about sending home care packages to soldiers and Marines that are deployed. That's the kind of thing that they were sent to get rid of that backlog. So what they did, in fact, in addition to breaking a barrier that had previously stood, is they were, by going through that mail and clearing out the backlog, they were letting many of the soldiers know that mom had no girlfriend or sister hadn't forgotten about them. Vice versa, when the mail is cleared going the other way. So they performed a critical function.
It was December 10th, 1944. Colonel Mack called me into his office and asked, "How would you like to go overseas?" I told him, "I haven't given the matter any thought, sir. When I first entered the service, I wanted to go, but since none of us are being sent overseas, I haven't permitted myself to think about it. It makes no difference to me, Colonel Mack. If I get orders to go, I'll go. So what can I say?"
Our orders said when we read them, go to London. We thought we were on our way to Paris. We didn't care where we were going. We were going to Paris. I had with me was my executive officer, Noel Cameron. And the two of us, they sent the two of us over here. The troops, we went ahead on the troops. So we got to England, and then we got to, and we reported to the senior rank officer there. We found out what we were going to do. We were going to be in the postal service. And then, so that we spent the next 2.5 to 3 weeks not only learning what our job was going to be, but what the troops were going to be, where they were going to be, what they were going to eat, where they were going to sleep, and where they were going, getting things ready for them. That's how we spent that particular time.
I was pretty surprised that she asked me when I got down to Fort Oglethorpe Church. She said that she wanted me to be her battalion executive officer. I said, "I don't know anything about that. I've been commanding officer ever since I left Fort Des Moines."
Way up in Harlem at a table for two.
That was four of us, B-O-B-T-Q.
From your ankles up, you show on me.
Yeah.
But from the down, it took me too much feet. Just your feet to me. Can't stand because your feet to me. Say, I can't tolerate you.
On the other hand, when they tried to disband the WAC band, the Negro WAC band, I understand that Adams was actually helpful in that case and making sure that it didn't happen, as well as the women themselves. Why they had a Negro WAC band in the first place? The regular WAC band did not accept African Americans. So they said, "We'll have our own band." And they were rather good, too. But they fought to make sure that band would not go out of place.
Birmingham, England. I was over to Spencer. The German soldier, but they had captured them. And they were so brutal to them, the American soldier. Well, I wasn't just used to that. And I didn't know. I said, and I always asked the American soldier, I said, "Why do y'all treat those boys like that, you know?" But they were so humble.
I'm most proud of the fact that I was able to get mail and packages to the people who were on the battlefront.
She had a tremendous job on her shoulders. What that did, though, is made her a little bit unpopular, because she wants those women to be spit and polished. You know, not a hair out of place. I'm not making light of it, but just to give you an example. Well, if the wind blows, the hair's going to be out of place, yes. But her job was to make sure that the best of the best was always presented, to get away from the stereotype, to show that black women could serve effectively and efficiently within the army.
Well, the first mail that I saw was the hangar full, and it was full of bags of mail and Christmas packages, which had been flown back from the continent back to England because of the Battle of the Bulge, which took place between December the 15th, 1944 and January the 15th, 1945. And in that particular time, they had to throw all the mail back because troops were at war and they were moving too fast, so the factories couldn't be delivered. So that was our really first job, take care of letters, cars, so forth, but get those Christmas packages to the troops as fast as you can. The first class had 440 people in it, 400 white and 40 black, and that we presumed was black, but we were all there. That's based on what was considered our population percentage in those days, that the blacks represented 10% of the whole population, and that's the way it was.
They didn't allow them, like the white whites, they had a recreational area in all the barracks. Well, the black whites did not have one permitted to have guests there. Don't forget, I told you they couldn't go to the officers' club. Where were they supposed to entertain them exactly? Well, at one point, the women broke the rule and had their male guests in the recreational area. It was reported, and Adams wrote them up. And they were appalled, because she knew exactly why they did have them in there. But she's saying, from Early's perspective, Adams' perspective, this is exactly what they expect you to do, because you can't handle rules and regulations, and I'm just not going to have it on my watch.
The only group of African-American WAC's women who served in the 6888 Central Postal Directory Battalion, the only group to serve overseas during the war. An estimated 855 African-American WACs, 824 enlisted women and 31 officers served with the 6888. The group served in England and France from January 1945 until March 1946. The battalion's members were rotated back to the United States at different times, depending on how long they had already served.
The white whites had been serving overseas for almost 2 years by this time. But for some reason, the usual black troops may make trouble, or blacks can't do what others are doing and whatnot. Overseas commanders did not want black women to come over.
I guess if there is anything that I remember about the Second World War, it was the fact that I was a member of the 6888 Central Postal Directory. It was the first and the only battalion of black women to serve overseas during the Second World War. And I'm very, very proud of that.
Their job was the redirecting mail that had one attempted delivery based on the last address the people back home had. But of course, in war times, you move pretty fast. Our job was not exciting, but it was necessary. It was necessary for the morale of the troops. Mail meant morale.
White rats were doing the mail. It was time for them to go home. And then they sent us, our troop over there, 831 officers, to clean up the mess. And we cleaned it up.
We got it done real quick. I think it was about 3 months. Then we went to Rouen, France, and the same amount of mail was there, and the girls got that out.
For some African American women, the military service prepared them for the future and their life after military service.
The job was guaranteed when you went back, but how long you kept it, there was no guarantee for anyone about that. When we came out, we had what we call the GI Bill, so I was able to go to college. And so college, being in the service, did help me then.
One of the colonels, a major somewhere from Eisenhower's, came out and called her one day to have a parade for him with her unit. Latrine was outside. He saw this one person go across me. He said, "Why is she? What's wrong with her?" And then she told us. She said, "Well, that's the 11th to 7th shift, and they're sleeping now."
I explained to him that they were working. There, one third of them were working, one third of them were asleep, and the other third were on their own terms.
He said, "Well, I told you to have everybody out there." She said, "No,
And I said, you expect them where they are this time. That didn't go too well.
But you know, he said, you can't have your unit. He said, well, I'm gonna bring a white woman in here to take your place. She said, like hell you would.
I was preparing to come home. I went to Tuskegee, Alabama to visit Noel and her family. I had to change trains in Atlanta. And aboard the second train, I prepared to settle down for the trip by putting my suitcase in the overhead luggage rack. As I raised the suitcase, a young Negro corporal moved forward to help me put the bag on the rack. As he reached me, he happened to notice my rank. I wore my uniform until my discharge the following month, but instead of helping me, he walked right past as if he had not seen me. But I heard him say softly, if she's strong enough to hold up those silver oak leaves, I guess she's strong enough to put her suitcase up on that rack. Acceptance of women in the military had not yet been accomplished. My Army career was almost over. I had decided to return to Ohio State University and complete the work for my master's degree, which I had begun before I joined the Corps. En route to Columbus, Ohio to return to graduate school, I stopped in Washington, D.C., where I met the noted Negro educator Mary McLeod Bethune. That evening, at a meeting of the National Council of Negro Women, she presented me with the organization's award for distinguished service.
I find this very difficult to believe because 3 days after VE Day, thousands of men, anxious to see women from home, regardless of race, were outside our quarters in Rouen, trying to get in the door.
When we first got to Berlin and the troops were in and we had done this great review we did for General Lee, the troops found soldiers and soldiers found troops and they all found the Red Cross clubs and the USO clubs and whatnot. And one day I looked out at my office window and I saw a tractor trailer backed up to the gym, which we call the Gymtorium. The Red Cross had sent us a truck full of stuff. And I made him take a little piece of it back. No, I didn't want it. The girls had been going to the club and they were happy. Why shouldn't they get a separate one now?
Seemed like to me. We were just working in like officers' barracks. Maybe it was the maid's cleanup or something like that. And then from there we went to Fort Jackson Road in training for medic.
African-American women contributed to or benefited from the armed services in different ways. Major Colonel Charity Adams Early stated in her book,
the trailblazing by the women who served in the military during World War II, the Korean War, and all forces of the armed service has been virtually ignored and forgotten. That is why I have written my story. In truth, I have accomplished much since my military service. I have opened a few doors, broken a few barriers, and I hope smoothed the way to some degree for the next generation. The problems that were my concern during my service and to which I have devoted my energies are still with us. But I keep trying.
I think I read in a recent biography of Truman that he served as vice president for 90 days before Roosevelt died, and then he is catapulted into leadership positions. I really believe that as we look at the Korean War, that we have to look at it as the beginning of the nuclear age, where war takes on a dimension heretofore unknown to humans. I have great sympathy with every president, even if those presidents have not been in favor of African Americans, but sympathy in the sense that what more difficult seat could someone sit in?
Male scholars tend to focus on the organizations and institutions and history that were led by men. With women, I think we're beginning to see more work in women's history because of the existence of the women's movement, the feminist movement.
You're just
too marvelous for words, like glorious, glamorous, and the old standby errors. It's all too wonderful. I'll never find the word. Let's say enough, tell enough. I mean, they just aren't swell enough. You're much too much, and just too very, very.
I see the Korean War as a time in history that changed the face of America. In so many ways, doors were opened for the soldiers and to show the world that they had the skills to walk to standards, go above and beyond standards, if you will, really. So I can actually feel for my soul that the plights and the energies that were put forth by the men and women of the Korean War that placed us where we are today as Army officers and Army enlisted people.
Veterans preference for jobs, which was very important when you consider the massive groups of women that came into the factories and other places to work. The popular theme of the time was Rosie the Riveter. But right when World War II ended, they were told, now you've done a great job, but you got to go home because these guys are coming home now and have to find work. Well, the female vet and the male vet, the common thing there is that they're veterans. So the preference points was very, very important.
So in 1950, when the Korean War started, we could truly say we still were in segregated units and alienated, if you will.
Executive Order 9981. You cannot deny the effect of it. But you also cannot deny it was a presidential election year. You also cannot deny, according to Clark Clifford, I'm a book advisor to the presidents, that he didn't think that Truman was an advocate for equality at all. It was a political necessity. But again, you can't deny the fact of what Truman did do, though. The executive order happened. It was law. And while it was slow to be obeyed, it was there to be obeyed. And we didn't have that previously.
On February 18, 1995, Lieutenant Colonel Charity Adams Early spoke in front of President Bill Clinton at the Defense Department ceremony honoring Black veterans of World War II. She reminded the audience that
we were there too.
I greet you with pride in having served my country, for the unity of purpose which created our successes, and for the lasting friendships we hold dear today. It's taken a long time for us to be found and remembered as participants. And tonight I feel especially honored to have this opportunity. In the United States of America, there's a form of address which applies to one person only, and I get to use it tonight.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
If ever there was evidence that this celebration is occurring at least 50 years too late, we can only marvel at the dedication that they manifested year in and year out, war in and war out from the first days of the Republic. In spite of being treated as second-class soldiers, segregated from their peers, sometimes shamefully harassed by comrades, still they served.
Charity Adams Early, commander of the 6888 Central Postal Directory Battalion in World War II, summarized the history of women in the military when she wrote in 1989.
The future of women in the military seems assured. What may be lost in time is the story of how it happened. The barriers of sex and race were and sometimes still are very difficult to overcome. The second even more than the first. During World War II, women in the service were often subject to ridicule and disrespect, even as they performed satisfactorily. Each year, the number of people who shared the stress of these accomplishments lessens. In another generation, young black women who join the military will have scant record of their predecessors who fought on the two fronts of discrimination, segregation and reluctant acceptance by males.
So the aunt really made a woman out of me. And I thought that I made a woman out of a lot of others who come into the service.
I might like to do it again, but it would take power, it would take wisdom, and it would take things that we haven't learned yet.
All I can say is you make the most of the opportunities, whatever they are. And we shouldn't waste a minute of our lives because life is too short.
I think the progress that we made, the fact that we did our job, made the road easier for that. No question in my mind about that. I had no problems going to the army in that day. I would urge or recommend anyone to go into the army in this day and time. There's too many things out there they could do. And we couldn't do in that day and time that they can do now. Blacks have the whole world open to them if they just step up. Now, that wasn't the case in our day and time.
A lot of times you talk to kids now, they have no concept of the fact that they're going to grow up and be a success at anything. And look at these people that came before them that had it much, much harder.
Absolutely.
Than they did, and that what they did, they succeeded.
Having been in the military, I did 23 and a half years. Military was my life. And so when I turned 21, I was married and I was a little reluctant to leave home until he went to the military, and then I decided to go. So I enlisted in 1944. Now, on Saturdays and Sundays, there were no formations. We went to the mess hall on our own, and we ate, you know. So women in my basic company decided that they were going to segregate themselves on Saturdays and Sundays. So one Saturday, we went down there, and they just sat at random at the various tables. And of course, some of the white girls got up and put the trays away, some of them moved, you know, that kind of thing. And when they got out to the various Black basic training company that was happening, we decided that we were going to make Saturdays and Sundays desegregation in the mess hall. Now, we knew what the colonel wanted. He said that in my basic training period, and during the time I was an officer, that as long as he was going to be there, there would be segregation in that post. But there was nothing he could do to change that order on Saturday and Sunday.
No gal made has got a shade on sweet Georgia Brown. Two left feet, but oh, so neat, sweet Georgia Brown. They all sigh, wanna die for sweet Georgia. I'll tell you why. You know I don't like much. It's been said she knocks them dead when she lands in town. Since she came, why it's a shame I wish she cools me down. Fellas, she can't get a fella she ain't met. Georgia claimed her, Georgia named her Sweet Georgia Brown. No gal maid has got the shade on Sweet Georgia Brown. 2 feet, but oh, so neat has Sweet Georgia Brown. They all sigh and won't die for Sweet Georgia Brown. I'll tell you just why.
You can clap if you want to. Sorry, we had to cut the credits. We're on the time, and we have to stay in focus based on the time. Thank you for coming out. Let's play a little Jeopardy game. Let me see who was sleeping or who was paying attention at this documentary. I'm going to ask you a question before you ask me some quick questions, and I want to hear your feedback on I'm gonna ask you 6 questions, and we'll see who was paying attention and who was sleeping. First question. 1941, Congressman Edith North Rogers introduced a bill on May 28th, 1941 to establish the WAAC, which was shortened to WAC. That same year, as you saw in the documentary, 56,000 to 60,000 white women were admitted into World War II, but black women were not allowed to come in. First question. Under pressure by Adam Clayton Powell, the NAACP, and the black press, African-American women were allowed to come into the armed forces. Who was the two key people to push for African-American women to come into the armed forces? First hand up, yes. Come up, you'll get a prize. Mary McLeod Bethune and Eleanor Roosevelt. Second question. 1942, President Franklin D. Roosevelt created the WAAC. That same year, 1942, the Army operated an officer training school, and it was mentioned in the documentary, at what fort, city and state? Yes. That's close enough. I'll give it to you. Come up. If you can. Excuse me. In 1945, the only African-American WAC women served was the Central Postal Directory. The only group that served overseas, they went to England and they went to France. What was that regiment's number?
6888.
Is that right? Yes, that was it. We'll give it to her. Your neighbor next to you.
She doubled up again.
Once again, the group served in England and it went to France during World War II. 1948, President Harry Truman issued an executive order to end racial segregation during World War II. What was that order number? It was in the documentary. Yes.
1981.
Yes. Excuse me?
1981.
998. I'll give it to you. That's
right.
You're coming.
All
right, thanks. Now, this is a tricky question, these next two. It's a two-in-one question. In the documentary, it was mentioned a 4-star general. He was the one that met the women coming off the boat from England. what was that four-star general's name? And second one, if you could answer that, his son was a commanding officer of what regiment during World War II? I'll make it easy for you. His son commanded the Tuskegee Airmen. Benjamin O. Davis, Sr. You get enough. Come up.
I'll take it.
And finally, one more. 1918, born 1918 and died 2002. Commanding officer of the Central Postal Directorate. She took her commands, her regiment to England and France during World War II. What was the full name? The full name. She was mentioned a zillion times in the documentary.
You have someone in the back.
Full name.
Charlie Adams Early.
Adams. Full name.
Charity Adams.
Major Charity.
Don't forget the rank.
I like to be consistent, but for you two, I'll give it to you. Thank you for your time, and I must point out for putting it back. Anybody that haven't had a chance to see this documentary, I believe they are streaming this. You got to find out when it's going to come on Facebook again later on this evening. And it is playing on a TV network in Washington called QWE TV. That's K-W-E-L-I TV. It is playing on that network. Of course, you $10 if you want to watch it. But what you saw was the 58-minute version. The full extent of this documentary is 90 minutes long. But for our time frame, we showed it. I hope you enjoyed it. Oh, can we up for two or three questions?
Okay. Yeah, give me two or three, but I got an next performer coming up.
Okay. Yes.
Why the name is Sweet George Brown? Why Sweet George Brown?
I really don't get that too often. The question was, why did I title it Sweet George Brown? When I was doing the research on this documentary at the National Archive and all the pictures I collected, the film footage that you saw was in black and white. So I converted those black and whites into, we call it sepia tone. It gives the texture, pulls out the texture of our skin, gives it more of a real look to me. That's my funky reason why I did it. I call it Georgia Brown. Yes?
Since they were volunteers, now
they're
active citizens, does that mean they can still
live? So
are they getting military credit?
Are they getting benefits and credit?
Well, yes. If they're still alive under the veterans' benefits, they are still getting the benefits as long as they're alive, yes.
Okay, good.
One more question, and that's it. I thank you. Yes.
What's next for you? What's next for you as far as documentary film?
I didn't get a chance to mention. I just finished up a project called Sankofa, African American 3D Museum. It's the first virtual reality 3D museum in the country and around the world. We launched last year, February. It's four floors of 3D museum focusing on African American history. It's a free site. You go to it, www.saa3dm.org. It's a free site, costs you nothing but time. Thank you for your time.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have a hand for the director, producer, writer, researcher, Lawrence Walker. Thank you, Lawrence. We were expecting a larger audience, and I must apologize to Lawrence because I really thought we'd get a better review, but we're going to try to bring this back because I think that's something that we really need to actually have more information on spread in our community.
Hey, Lord.
Now, today is our culture and entertainment day of our Black History Expo. Let me see what you want.
Just let them know it's on our Facebook page as well.
This information will also be on our Facebook page. So if you want to follow up, we'll also be able to find this information on our Facebook page. We just live streamed it while we were doing it. Now, As I said, this is the Black History Expo done by the New Black Wall Street Market. And we thought that we would end the Black History Month with some culture and entertainment. So I have a full weekend of events and programs planned for you. Now, what we did was we brought together the history. I have for you a very historical event about to take place. His name is Dr. Daniel Dominique. And Dr. Dominique, I have his bio in my phone, I gotta go back to it and find, is a native of South America. And very few of us know or are aware of the fact that the African was taken from our country and spread out around the world, but we have over 200 million black people in South America. Africans, descendants of, just like we are, of the African continent. And next we're gonna have a presentation by Dr. Daniel Dominique. He is an author, filmmaker, public speaker, global leader, successful entrepreneur, and known the world over as a renowned visionary. Dr. Daniel Dominique is using his creative, innovative, futuristic mindset to bring change and formulation in the black community. Dr. Daniels is an author of a new book called, I can't pronounce the title, say it for me out loud.
Duka.
Duka Land, which talks about the runaway African and surrender. Without any further ado, I introduce you to your brother, someone that you need to meet. That's the South African, descendants of the same slave trade that brought us to America, Dr. Dominique. Come forward, please, my brother.